Chapter 23.
My dear Wormwood, I have been in correspondence with Slumtrimpet, who is in charge of your patient's young woman, and begin to think I see a chink in her armor. It is an unobtrusive little vice, which she shares with nearly all women who have grown up in an intellectual circle, united by a clearly defined belief. And it consists of a quite untroubled assumption that the outsiders who do not share this belief are just really too stupid and ridiculous. The males who habitually meet these outsiders do not feel this way. Their confidence, if they are confident, is of a different kind. Hers, which she supposes is due to faith, is in reality largely due to the mere color she has taken from her surroundings. It is not, in fact, very different from the conviction she would have felt at the age of 10 that the real kind of fish knives used in her father's house were the proper or normal or real kind, while those of a neighboring family were not real fish knives at all. Now, the element of ignorance and naivete in all this is so large, and the element of spiritual pride so small, that it gives us little hope of the girl herself. But have you thought of how it can be made to influence your own patient? It is always the novice who exaggerates. The man who has risen in society is over-refined. The young scholar is pedantic. In this new circle, your patient is a novice. He is there daily meeting Christian life of a quality he never before imagined, and seeing it all through an enchanted glass, because he is in love. He is anxious. Indeed, the enemy commands him to imitate this quality. Can you get him to imitate this defect in his mistress, and to exaggerate it until what was venial in her becomes in him the strongest and most beautiful of the vices? Spiritual pride? The conditions seem ideally favorable. The new circle in which he finds himself is one of which he is tempted to be proud for many reasons other than its Christianity. It is a better educated, more intelligent, more agreeable society than any he has yet encountered. He is also under some degree of illusion as to his own place in it. Under the influence of love, he may still think himself unworthy of the girl, but he is rapidly ceasing to think himself unworthy of the others. He has no notion how much in him is forgiven, because they are charitable and made the best of, because he is now one of the family. He does not dream how much of his conversation and how many of his opinions are recognized by them all as mere echoes of their own. Still less does he suspect how much of the delight he takes in these people is due to the erotic enchantment which the girl, for him, spreads over all her surroundings. He thinks that he likes their talk and way of life because of some congruity between their spiritual state and his, when in fact they are so far beyond him that if he were not in love, he would merely be puzzled and repelled by much of what he now accepts. He is like a dog, which should imagine it understood firearms, because its hunting instinct and love for its master enable it to enjoy a day's shooting. Here is your chance. While the enemy, by means of sexual love and of some very agreeable people far advanced in his service, is drawing the young barbarian up to levels he could never otherwise have reached, you must make him feel that he is finding his own level, and that these people are his sort, and that, coming among them, he has come home. When he turns from them to other society, he will find it dull, partly because almost any society within his reach is, in fact, much less entertaining, but still more because he will miss the enchantment of the young woman. You must teach him to mistake his contrast between the circle that delights and the circle that bores him for the contrast between Christians and unbelievers. He must be made to feel, he'd better not put it into words, how different we Christians are, and by we Christians, he must really, but unknowingly, mean my set, And by my sect, he must mean not the people who, in their charity and humility, have accepted me, but the people with whom I associate by right. Success here depends on confusing him. If you try to make him explicitly and professedly proud of being a Christian, you will probably fail. The enemy's warnings are too well known. If, on the other hand, you let the idea of we Christians drop out altogether and merely make him complacent about his set, you will produce not true spiritual pride, but mere social vanity, which, by comparison, is a trumpery, puny little sin. But what you want is to keep a sly self-congratulation mixing in with all his thoughts, and never allow him to raise the question, what precisely am I congratulating myself about? The idea of belonging to an inner circle, of being in a secret, is very sweet to him. Play on that nerve. Teach him, using the influence of this girl, when she is silliest, to adopt an air of amusement at the things unbelievers say. Some theories, which he may meet in modern Christian circles, may prove helpful. Theories, I mean, that place the hope of society in some inner ring of clerks, some trained minority of theocrats. It is no affair of yours whether those theories are true or false. The great thing is to make Christianity a mystery religion in which he feels himself one of the initiates. Pray do not fill your letters with rubbish about this European war. Its final issue is no doubt important, but that is a matter for the High Command. I am not in the least interested in knowing how many people in England have been killed by bombs, and what state of mind they died. I can learn from the office at this end. That they were going to die sometime, I already knew. Please keep your mind on your work. Your affectionate uncle, Screwtape.